Recorded Books and RB Digital present Dealing Death and Drugs, The Big Business of Dope in the U.S. and Mexico by Beto O'Rourke and Susie Byrd. Narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross and Andrea Gallo. Introduction. 2008 was different. El Paso sits on the Rio Grande, a.k.a. the U.S.-Mexico border, across from Ciudad Juarez. I was born here. My co-author Susie Byrd moved to El Paso with her family when she was 7. Each of us grew up a few minutes from the river and Ciudad Juarez. This experience is the lens through which we write this book. This is where Latin America and North America meet to form the largest binational community in the world. It's the point at which the 400-year-old Camino Real de Tierra Adentro, after having passed through Mexico City, Durango, Chihuahua, and Juarez, crosses into present-day U.S. territory, continuing north through El Paso and on to Santa Fe, New Mexico. This book is about what happens in our community when the value of the drugs that move through this ancient trade corridor exceeds the value of human life. We will explore the economy of the illegal drug trade, with a focus on that drug the cartels find most important to their bottom line, marijuana. With first-person accounts, court transcripts, and federal data, we will demonstrate how this simple weed has become the center of a multi-billion-dollar industry. This industry is powerful enough to threaten governments, command horrifying violence, and inspire the creation of outsized laws and budgets in the U.S., laws which end up strengthening the very cartels they were created to put out of business. We conclude by reviewing a previous experiment with prohibition and offer a solution that can undermine the power of the cartels and produce positive outcomes for both the U.S. and Mexico. At first drive-through, El Paso can feel like a richer, if more staid, suburb of Juarez, and Juarez can feel like a more exciting, if poorer, suburb of El Paso. El Paso has the tall downtown bank buildings, the ordered system of freeways and streets, the manicured lawns in distinct subdivisions. Juarez has the streetlife, the staggering swings between rich and poor, and the invigorating chaos of 350 years of ad hoc construction and twisting streets named for ghosts of the revolution. Bob Dylan sings about Juarez. El Paso gets Marty Robbins. But the cities have each other. El Paso is over 500 miles from the Texas state capital and light years from Washington, D.C. Juarez is the same distance, for all practical purposes, from Mexico's centers of power and population. So far away from the interest and focus of the state or feds, isolated from other major cities by hundreds of miles of barren desert plateau, the conjoined communities have long relied on each other in the development of their commerce, families, and culture. The vast majority of El Paso is of Mexican descent. If charted, the family trees of most would show ancestors from Juarez and other smaller cities at the frontier state of Chihuahua. Cross-border family reunions are a common daily affair taking place in both Juarez and, especially these days, El Paso. There is a distinct Spanish spoken in El Paso, Pocho, inflected with code-switched local phrases that I heard and spoke as I grew up. I only learned later in El Paso High Spanish class that I te huacho is not the proper way to take leave of one's friend. While not a perfect melting pot, El Paso has long been a remarkably tolerant community. Many of my friends in grade school were first or second generation U.S. citizens whose families crossed over from Mexico. Others were Mexican citizens and claimed residency at the home of El Paso relatives or family friends in order to attend school here. The distinction between Anglo and Mexican American stood out, as do all distinctions at that age, but it was a distinction that lacked enough difference or meaning to determine who would or would not become a friend. All of us spent time in Juarez. When we were young, we'd go to the markets and restaurants with our parents. As we got older, it was the nightclubs and bars. And when we were adults, it was back to the restaurants and markets with our own kids. Juarez was a destination for pleasure and fun, a place to take visitors to gawk and be entertained and then go home. You drank beer for 50 cents a bottle, bought some trinkets at the market, and maybe walked by the old cathedral. Having to pay your way out of a real or imagined traffic violation was about the worst that could happen. Growing up, I would hear about drug busts on the news, but it was such a common occurrence that it tended to blend into the background, like the weatherman forecasting sunshine. While there is a rich history of black market trafficking in Juarez, going back at least to the U.S. alcohol prohibition of the 1920s, as a child, I didn't understand or make the connection between the city next door and the news about drugs. If I ever did, it was only with the most passing of interests. The news reports of cocaine or marijuana seizures were at times followed by one of a number of anti-drug commercials whose taglines I can still remember. For example, "This is your brain on drugs," or "I learned it from watching you, Dad." In hindsight, their ineffectiveness is obvious. But at the time, it was not something I paid much attention to since I didn't use drugs and I wasn't interested in the subject. This was not the case for all of my friends, though. Some friends tried drugs, or at least had enough working knowledge of drugs, to convince the rest of us that they knew what they were talking about. I remember a seventh-grade classmate at Mesita Elementary who not only bragged about getting high, but was caught selling dope to a janitor. He was the exception. Most kids I knew didn't try pot until later, when it was offered to them at high school parties or while drinking in the functionally all-ages bars of Ciudad Juarez. As I grew older and listened to the news a little more carefully, I learned that Juarez was the crossing point for many of the drugs, and certainly all of the dope, sold and used in El Paso. Every so often, there would be news of another big bust. Tons of marijuana interdicted at the border coming over from Juarez, or bundles of cash and cocaine uncovered in a stash house in El Paso. The sheer tonnage and enormous street value of these interdictions made it obvious that the Juarez-El Paso land port was an important logistical hub in the North American drug trade. But I didn't think that it affected me, so I didn't pay much attention. In college, marijuana was even more available than it had been in high school. People smoked openly at parties, in dorm rooms, and out on the streets. Given everything that has happened in Juarez in the last few years, the fact that it is now the deadliest city in the world and the focus of the combined drug interdiction efforts of the U.S. and Mexico, it amazes me how little I knew or cared about these issues before. Having lived 35 years of my life within the front lines of the declared drug war, having seen drug use around me since middle school, having known that billions of dollars in drugs were transiting through my community, until 2008, I can't remember ever thinking about drug policy, much less caring about it. Violent death isn't a new phenomenon in Juarez. I can remember spasms of killings in Juarez that would temporarily halt the flow of El Pasoans crossing the international bridges in search of cosmopolitan restaurants, frenetic street life, cheap booze, and the unquestioned welcome for school kids and GIs who wanted to get their rocks off. But these cycles of violence, for those of us who are only indirectly affected, were treated like an intermittent natural phenomenon. Like the weather. It would be bad for a little while and then get better. And what made it even easier to keep as an abstraction and not let it get to you was the convenient assumption that it only affected bad people, those who were involved in the drug trade. 2008 was different. For the 15 years before 2008, the average number of murders per year in Juarez was 236. The murders of 316 people in 2007, the most in decades, produced a level of anxiety in the Juarez community that was unseen even during the femicides of the 1990s, when hundreds of women were abducted and murdered. So when 1,623 people were murdered in 2008, the number was outside of anyone's realm of reference or possibility. 2008 was different in another way. People weren't just murdered, they were brutalized. Tortured, maimed, shot, knifed, strangled, set on fire, hanged, dismembered, beheaded. One at a time. 1,623 times in all. But perhaps the most shocking distinction provided by the carnage of that year was not the number or manner of killings, but just who was being killed. Not only were young and middle-aged men dying, the presumed profile of the cartel workforce, so were women, pregnant mothers, the elderly and young children. No one was spared, and everyone, it seemed, was a potential victim. The news media and the governments of Mexico and the U.S. were telling us that this spike in violence was linked to two wars that had just been announced. The first was President Felipe Calderón's war against the cartels. The second was Chapo Guzman's war against the Juarez cartel for control of the valuable transit route leading from Juarez into El Paso and the rest of the U.S. drug market, valued between $63 and $81 billion. At first, these two narratives made it easy to dismiss the awful bloodshed as nothing more than settled scores amongst cartels. While hard to prove, since almost none of the murders were ever solved, it made sense and fit nicely with the long-taken view in the region that as long as you were clean and steered clear of the drug trade, you had nothing to worry about. But as the numbers, details, and circumstances of the victims became known, the conclusion was unavoidable. Something new and tragic was taking place in Juarez, and it wasn't going to go away no matter how hard we tried to ignore it. As if to reinforce the permanence of the problem, families, especially those with money and connections, began to trickle, and then stream, out of Juarez and into El Paso. They bought homes, enrolled their children in local schools, and started businesses and new careers. By the end of 2008, the mayor of Ciudad Juarez himself was living safe and secure in El Paso, along with an estimated 30,000 other newly expatriated Juarenses. The rate and brutality of the murders and reigning impunity in Juarez forced me to consider a number of questions. Why were good people dying as well as bad people? Could that distinction even be measured? And if it could, did it matter? More bluntly, did anyone deserve to die like this? And lastly, and most importantly, what role did I have in this? As a fourth-generation El Pasoan, and since 2005 a member of the El Paso City Council, whose 80,000-person district borders Mexico, I didn't want to sit by and witness all of this and do nothing. I wanted to understand and to act. It became clear that this was not a simple problem. There were a number of contributing factors that one could point to, from the rapid industrialization of Juarez, a decades-long transformation that had attracted hundreds of thousands of people from the surrounding countryside to work in factories without the social and civic infrastructure to support them, to the absence of any true respect for the rule of law, expressed in the bribing of police and the obsequiousness paid to drug lords and leading patriarchs alike. Rule of the strong and not the law was seemingly bred into the bones of the city. But there was perhaps an even more pernicious influence acting on Juarez in these years. The more I thought about it as the number of murdered rose in 2008, the clearer it became that Juarez was caught in a multi-billion dollar hemispheric vice between supply and demand. North America consumes illegal drugs, Mexico supplies them. When there is interference between the supply and demand, people start dying. At the same time that I was thinking about what city council could do to help, others in the city were working on these same questions, including the City of El Paso's Committee on Border Relations. Comprised of academic, business, and government leaders, the group offered a resolution in response to the Juarez violence to the El Paso City Council for adoption in early 2009. It made a number of important policy recommendations, including encouraging stronger interdiction efforts to stop the southbound guns and cash that armed and empowered the killers, encouraging Mexico to strengthen its institutions and respect for rule of law, and urging both countries to work harder to stop and treat drug use. As the resolution was being presented to the City Council, I asked whether we should more aggressively address the issues related to demand and prohibition. I listened to the answers, followed the debate among my colleagues, and then offered an amendment, composed on the spot, to encourage an honest, open, national debate on ending the prohibition on narcotics. It was an artless and even inaccurate amendment to the larger resolution. I only learned later that marijuana is not a narcotic, even though it was precisely that drug that I felt people would be most open to debating. But it got the point across. I knew we were addressing a taboo topic, one that conventional wisdom dictated that only potheads, hardcore libertarians, and political suicides ever brought up. But I also knew that Juarez had gone well beyond the pale, and it was time to place all options on the table, even those that had been unthinkable, for me as well as others just a year ago. The resolution, including the amendment I offered on an honest, open debate, passed unanimously. I was surprised. The eight of us, myself, Anne Lilly, Susie Byrd, Emma Acosta, Melina Castro, Rachel Quintana, Eddie Olguin, and Steve Ortega, could rarely agree on anything, from setting the tax rate to whether or not we should have bike lanes. And yet, on one of the most politically charged topics in the nation, we were in unanimous agreement. It was testament to the fact that, despite our differences, we were all El Pasoans who understood at a basic level that our fellow fronterizos were dying, that the safety and welfare of the city we represented was under threat, and that our long-term future was in doubt. We wanted to do something to make our voices heard, and voting for this non-binding resolution became our opportunity. Later in the day, Mayor John Cook surprised us by vetoing the resolution that he'd been mum on throughout the meeting where it had been debated. When confronted, he cited a concern that we'd be laughed out of Austin and D.C. when we went begging for our allotment of state and federal funds. I trusted that the leaders in our state and national capitals, and more importantly, the people in El Paso, would understand that this was no laughing matter. I resolved to try to override the veto and placed it on the next Tuesday's City Council agenda. On the day before the vote, council members began to receive calls from our congressman, Silvestre Reyes, chair of the powerful House Intelligence Committee. He asked us not to move forward with the resolution and delivered a thinly veiled threat. Failure to do so would result in the withholding of stimulus funds for our city, the third poorest in the United States. The question now was, would we have the courage of our convictions? The congressman's El Paso chief of staff, Sal Payan, addressed the council on the congressman's behalf in the public meeting the next day. He reiterated the congressman's vague threats and urged us to desist. His efforts paid off. 6 votes were needed to override the mayor's veto, and it became clear as we took a roll call vote that only 4 were sticking with their original votes. Each of the council members who folded cited the federal blackmail. City Representative Eddie Olguin, one of the most conservative members of the council, said, "I don't regret supporting the resolution, but at this point, I can't jeopardize funding from the."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.